Hello, everyone. Good morning. It is Xanet Pailet with the Power of Pleasure. And we are talking love, sex, and intimacy, which, by the way, is the name of my new Facebook group. And sometime during this post, I will put that up because I would love for you to be able to join us there so that we can talk about love, sex, and intimacy. Good morning, Avi. So today we're going to talk about how to ask for what you want during sex. And this is really perfect because I got this letter. God, I hate when this happens. Swipe left to see your viewers. There we go. I got this email the other day, and it was the perfect email to talk about during today's Facebook Live event. So let me read it to you. This is what it says. So I have this question regarding orgasms during sex. How does one start a conversation or show one's partner what he needs to do during sex, obviously coming from a woman, in order for you to reach an orgasm? I personally can only have an orgasm through clitoral stimulation, and he doesn't seem to be doing it right. And I don't have any idea how to talk to him about it. Guess you can say I'm embarrassed and or shy about it because I don't know how he's going to react to it or say or even do. Can you help? What a great question, because there are so many different layers in that question. And yet this is an issue. I'm gonna take my glasses off. I don't think I need it right now. This is a really important issue and a really common issue that happens to women and men during sex, but I see it happen a lot more to women. And this is actually being asked by a woman. So I'm gonna address this from the woman's perspective. So let me try to unpack this for you because there are really interesting layers. So the first piece really is the whole issue around the communication piece, right? How do I even begin to communicate to my partner about what I want because I feel some embarrassment and some shame and some uncomfort around that? So this goes really directly to the Facebook Live video I did last week, which was about understanding your sexual blueprint, because that's where our, hey Kai, that's where our sexual shame comes from. And just to give you the 2 second overview, that sexual blueprint are the messages that you received around sex as a child. And for many of us, whatever messages we received made it pretty clear that talking about sex was kind of taboo. It wasn't something that we could equally and easily embrace, and that made it very challenging. So, of course, as an adult, when you get into these type of conversations, when you want to be able to tell your partner what you like, but you're feeling uncomfortable about it, those childhood messages, that shame really shows up for us. So I think the first thing is just to acknowledge, wow, there's some discomfort here. And I'm feeling into that discomfort. Good morning, Jeff. I'm feeling into that discomfort as well. And I can just acknowledge that that's there and I'm kind of living with that. So here are some practical things that you can do in order to be able to start to discuss with your partner what you actually want during sex. And the first thing is, at some point, there has to be a conversation, right? One of you, in this case, I'm suggesting that the woman who asks this question, broaches it with her partner and says, you know, can we talk about what happens during sex? Can we talk about what we like and what we don't like? My friend Reed Mahalko has this really wonderful, he calls it his, I think the elevator speech, the sex elevator speech, where anytime you're about to have a sexual interaction with somebody, especially when it's a new partner, you have this conversation where you talk about not only your STI history and, you know, the protection that you want to use, other partners that you have, but also kind of like, these are the things that I like and these are the things that I don't like. So if you could actually have a conversation with your partner, that obviously would be the most ideal way to be able to approach this. But that's not always possible, right? Sometimes those communication, oral communication, is a little challenging. So here's another way to do this, and I have found this to be really successful. Each take a piece of paper, and you each write down five things that you want your partner to do to you, like on a piece of paper, and five things you would like to be able to do to your partner during sex. And then you each like compare your lists, and there it always sparks some sort of conversation. Sometimes writing, you can do this on your phones too, you guys. Sometimes writing about what you want as opposed to talking about what you want, giving yourselves a little bit of distance, can actually start to help you overcome some of that shame and some of that discomfort, right? But the bottom line is there has to be communication. There's no way to be able to ask for what you want if you're not communicating with each other. I also want to recommend this new, what is it called? There's a new app called Pillow Talk. And a lot of people really have been saying really good things about Pillow Talk. I myself haven't read it. I haven't used it. I did read the reviews and it's gotten really good reviews. But again, it's another way to help individuals, partners start to be able to communicate more about their sexual needs. Okay. Here's another thing that you can do. So what I got from this email is that this woman and her partner were in the middle of having sex when there was an outcome that she was looking for, which is that she was looking to have her clitoral orgasm, which is the only way she believes that she can orgasm. So there's a lot of pressure in that situation. She's wanting something to happen, and he's wanting something to happen as well. And that makes it challenging to be in a place where you can actually experience and be able to talk about what you need. So another potential way to address this is to, with your partner, decide that you're just gonna have a night of sort of sexual, maybe playing doctor, or a research and development night. A research and development night where, rather than having a particular outcome like, oh, we're definitely gonna end up having intercourse, or there's definitely an intention for us to both have an orgasm. Hi guys, hi Kim. You guys can send me hearts, I would like that. I don't know if you know how to do that. You have a night where you just get to discover each other's bodies, and you know, just take it from the perspective of like you were children, and it's very playful, kind of beginner's mindset, and taking turns just experimenting with what each other likes and trying different things without having any necessity for an outcome or feeling like you have to have an outcome will really take the pressure off. So it may be a lot easier for you to be able to ask for what you want in a much more non-pressured situation, right? Like a much more low-risk situation. Okay, a third component of this is how you give your feedback. How you give your feedback. For example, your tone of voice. If you're very critical about what your partner is doing, that may make your partner like freeze and feel like not want to continue. Or you might get a negative reaction, and that may be why you're concerned that you don't want to tell them that what they're doing isn't working for them. So I think tone of voice is really important. Also, everybody needs praise, right? You know, I think we all come to sex with different levels of experience and different levels of education. And let's face it, how many of us have really had any type of real education about how to have sex, how to touch a woman's clitoris, how to touch a man's penis, right? that just doesn't really exist in our country. And unless you've watched some videos or you've gone to some classes, you don't have that information either. So I think we all do the best that we can. And often we either get our information from a past partner because something that we did actually worked for them, or we get our information from watching television, or we've just gotten our information from, you know, exploring, like, this is how I learned how to do this particular act or this particular move. But making sure that we're praising our partner in addition to asking for something else really does make a difference. So rather than saying like, ooh, that doesn't feel good. I mean, if it really feels horrible, right, you should never accept touch that doesn't feel good, either women or men, right? Nobody should tolerate bad touch that's really painful. You've got to stop that. But a better way to say it might be like, what you did before felt really good, but that's not feeling as juicy for me. Can we try something different, right? So giving a little bit of praise before you give the correction can make a really big world of difference. Another thing is that, and again, this is a hetero couple, clearly man touching, trying to help a woman touch her clitoris. Another thing that you can do is to show your partner what you like, right? Every woman's vulva, every woman's vagina, every woman's clitoris is different. We have different touch that we like. We have different stimulation that works for us. I mean, it's all different. And very often the best thing that you can do for your partner is just to demonstrate, like, this is the way I really like my clitoris to be stroked, right? With whatever type of pressure that you like, whatever the pace is that you want, right? So you need to be, you know, to demonstrate what you like. And here's one of the things I really want to address, because in this email, she made this big assumption. Let me read it to you again. I'm gonna put my glasses on. She says that she has no idea how to talk to him about it. She's embarrassed and or shy about it because she doesn't know how he's going to react or say or what he's going to do. So I think that there's this very common fear that we have as women in particular, and again, I'm talking to hetero couples at the moment, or women's arousal, that that our partner is going to get really upset when we ask for something different or we give them some guidance. And I really want to say that my experience, having worked with, you know, hundreds of men and taught hundreds of men in classes as well, is that in general, men and your partner really wants to please you. They want you to feel good. They want to help you get to whatever it is that you want. Usually it's an orgasm, right? They actually really want to assist you and help you and please you. And, you know, I think that what I hear from men is how relieved they are when their partner actually tells them what they want. And I get this all the time, right? I'm somebody who's a super good communicator during sex. And partners always say to me, like, wow, I love that you know exactly what you want. It helps me because as I said, every woman's vulva is totally different. And what worked for one woman and one partner may not work for the other. And not only that, every time that we have sex, we're going to have a different response. So what worked yesterday may not work today. So the more that you as a woman and we as women can know what we want and be able to share that with our partner, the more likely we're going to get something that we want. And I really want to dispel this myth that for most men that their ego gets bruised or they get upset or they feel like they're incompetent and don't know what they're doing. They really want, my experience is that most men really appreciate having that information. It's the way in which you convey it to that person that will make the difference between their ego being bruised and just feeling like, oh, okay, this is a woman who knows what she wants and I really want to be able to please her. Another way to be able to do this, to show your partner how you like to be touched, but another option is for you guys to have a mutual touching session, meaning that you each take turns, or you could do it at the same time, touching yourselves, having a mutual masturbation session, so that you both can actually see how you get aroused, what works for you, what type of pressure you like, how to build it up or to slow it down, right? So again, the more that you can show each other and share what you like and what you want to experience, the more likely you're going to get what you actually want, and you'll be able to ask for what you want during sex. And then the last point that I really want to cover is the fact that she's talking about touching her clitoris. So in the classes that I teach, my men's workshop, and actually any of you in the Bay Area on Monday, this coming Monday at Good Vibrations on Pope Street, I'm teaching a short workshop about women's sexual arousal. Would love for you guys to be there. We talk about, you know, how you touch a woman, and being really clear that very often men tend to go right for the clitoris, and a woman needs time to be warmed up. We actually need our extremities to be warmed up. Our arousal takes a lot longer than man's arousal. But in particular, the clitoris is super, super, super sensitive. And if you take your finger and you, my pinky, and you just rub your eyebrow, and you keep on rubbing, not your eyebrow, your eyelid, and you keep on rubbing your eyelid for, you know, a few moments, you'll start to notice that it starts feeling scratchy, like there's sand on it and it hurts. And that's very similar to what it feels like for a woman's clitoris to be touched when she's not aroused enough and she's not actually ready for more sexual arousal on her clitoris. And very often, and again, this varies from woman to woman, but very often, you know, clitorises get engorged. It's erectile tissue. So the more the woman gets aroused, the larger the clitoris becomes, and typically it can start to take more pressure. But some women have super, super sensitive clitorises, and they don't like direct pressure. They actually need to have indirect pressure on the hood that covers the clitoris. And other women like really, really hard pressure. And it often will vary, right? Sometimes you need very, very light pressure in the beginning, building up to more intense pressure as you get more and more and more aroused. It's not unlike really a man's penis, right? Same thing. It's actually very, very similar tissue and structures. So that may be another piece that he's not doing it right, because he doesn't know how to touch a clitoris and the sensitivity that some women have around their clitorises, or is it a clitori? I don't know. So that's another thought, is like making sure that, you know, that your partner has some guidance and experience about the type of touch that you want on your clit to be able to get you to orgasm. But this has to be communicated, and I have strong confidence that you will be able to find ways to communicate. I'm talking to the woman who wrote me this email, that you'll be able to find ways to be able to communicate with your partner about what it is that you really want during sex. So I want to just say again that I just created a new Facebook group. It's called Talking Love, Sex, and Intimacy with Xanet. It's a closed group, which I think means you have to apply to join it, so that we are able to manage it a little bit. It's a it's open to both women and men. And I would love for you guys to join me on that Facebook group. This is the end of today's, I guess we're gonna call it, Talking Love, Sex, and Intimacy Live with Xanet. And I will see you guys next Friday at 10. I also wanna encourage you, if you have a question, you can post it in the Facebook group and I will address it on these Facebook Live sessions, or you can send me an email at Xanet, X-A-N-E-T, at powerofpleasure.com. xanetpailet.com. And this video will also be available on my YouTube channel. It's Power of Pleasure. You can just look at, I think it's Xanet POP. That's the easy way to get it. And I'll put that all up on the video as well. Have a great weekend, you guys. Bye.